highways to travel, electricity need highways so that it can travel from different places to different. Longer the lines, higher voltage lines are covering longer distance, 400 kV still cover subsequently longer distance. And then interstate, within state, it is 220 kV, 110 kV, depending on the how big state is. A state like Maharashtra may need 400 kV within the state itself. A state like Goa, 220 kV is sufficient, the distance would be 100 kilometers or 120 kilometers. So at 220 kV, within interstate transmission happens. But the incoming grid thing is at 400 kV. At least at like the moment, future it will be 765, 400 mix. So now at 400 kV. So only when 2003 you got connected with the national grid, you got a sufficient power enough. For that event, 17 years have passed. We are in 2020 now. And so what has happened is the whole reliability factor or the dependency factor has gone on Western grid. Out of total capacity Goa can draw as on date today, goes to 690 megawatt. Now there are the various figures what Goa has reached a peak. There is a peak reached of 654 also, on an average from say 630, 625. Even I think Chief Engineer also a few days ago declared in the newspaper that they are on 630 megawatt peak has reached. So 690 is the actual capacity they can draw. And 630 is the whatever we already reached. 630 to 654 is already touched. So with those figures, I guess it is not much to understand that the excess, if we call, so-called, is only 40 megawatt as on date. And 40 megawatt is like what? 650 ka even like 2% of 650 will be more than, or 1% also will be more than. So in next 2 years itself, you are going to cross 690. That is for sure. And in fact, even more. Because traditionally, Goa has always bet the forecast. Whatever the forecast of power has been meant for Goa, Goa has exceeded the forecast every time. It's good. It's good because that much of activities happen, that much of tourism and all those kind of things, industries, public consumption is also increasing. So it is continuously increasing. So that is what it is. So 690 megawatt. Now the interesting part of 690 megawatt is the breakup. Out of 690, 590 megawatt comes from Western grid. Hardly 100 megawatt, just a minuscule share, comes from south. Dependency on that 220 kV line which is connected to Karnataka. Which line, if you ask any Goa electricity person, that they are really fed up with that particular line. The reason is that's not a national grid or something. That is an arrangement with the neighboring state. Goan part is taken care of by Goa. Karnataka portion of maintenance is taken care of by Karnataka. So whenever a problem happens in Karnataka, the line gets slow. If it is Goa, these people are responsible. They are taking maximum care or whatever, they will go and fix it also. But Karnataka, it's like request on request goes on, please take it up. Still it happens, sometimes happens after 5 days, 10 days or whatever. So the reliability is completely irrelevant there. And so I think right, there is a reason also the dependency only kept to 100 megawatt. Whatever you get from Ramagundam is coming to that source. Now if you see 590 and 100, what's the ratio? 85-50, almost, roughly somewhere. So imagine a scenario where Western grid side, the main power is coming on a double circuit 400 kV, major. Something happens, which does happen, something happens, cyclone happens, anything happens. Couple of towers are down. It means the line is distorted, line is gone. So unless and until you bring them up and restore the line, you won't get a supply. What is at stake for Goa? 590 megawatt comes from Western grid. If 590 megawatt goes, or say 500 megawatt also goes, does Goa has a capacity to boost it up from other side? You are already in this field of news, so you must be aware. Maybe a couple of months back, there was a big event happened in Mumbai. Mumbai was blacked out because of failures and cumulative failures of lines, and then grid was failed. It's a big national news, huge crores of money gone wasted or like, you know, losses because of few hours of blackout. Few hours. Now that is Mumbai. They only had to bring it back. Start the grid, they have other systems and all, they have to bring it back. So it could happen in 6 hours, 7 hours time. What will Goa do? They don't have any other facility to get that kind of power. Now this project requirement also I can connect it with, you know, Kashmir. 2012, Kashmir actually had a similar situation. Kashmir had only one field to connect with the main national grid. That got failed. As we all know, Kashmir, it's snowfall and all those things. In that harsh conditions, it got failed. The entire thing was blacked out. State went into blackout for 25 days. It took 25 days of warlike preparation to restore the line and get it. That time, Kashmir government demanded we need an additional source. Now, question was how to build it, because it was very, very tough terrain. Where they are trying to get the big field, it was a very tough terrain. So, almost everybody was giving up. But how to get line from this side? It's mountains, it's snow, it's sub-zero degree temperatures and all those kind of factors. And that time, but it was a need. And it was an express-based project design. And similar that time, so again, that project at that time was decided by government to put it on TBCB mode, which this has come. TBCB mode is nothing but tariff-based competitive bidding. Earlier also lines were getting constructed, but it was government planning something, infrastructure, and then government company was taking up the infrastructure development. So Power Grid is always there. Without any bidding or anything, Power Grid was just starting the works. They used to do the works on cost-plus basis as a government project. So whatever it takes time and all. So that was decided, this requires short time. So we should have that kind of binding also. That's why this project was put up on TBCB mode. TBCB model started somewhere 10, 12 years back when the privatization or like private partnership started, basically I would say. So this project on TBCB mode, again we are proud to say that Sterlite did this project. Kashmir project was taken by Sterlite and tariff was bidding, and that was completed 1 year prior to schedule. And I won't say it's only us, it's thanks to the whole cooperation, because it was need of the hour. So everybody was very much willing to make sure that the project happens. And we put all our efforts, all the technology we know, whatever we could learn, and we got that up and running. The reason to tell you about that is we are sitting exactly on the similar scene. As long as it is good, it's good. Things, as you say, no? As long as we never tasted it, it's fine. But imagine the scenario if we have it. What we will do, and that's the reason this was the answer. Again, the Goa sits on the same thing, so that is why even in 39th SCM, Goa categorically asked that we need an additional feed from south, we need a connectivity with the southern grid. So that is how this project got designed. So the first major element was to get a substation in South Goa. Why substation in South Goa? Now you are only one substation for 400 kV in North Goa. And that too at just the entry point of Goa, at the border of Maharashtra, near Kolwale and Mapusa you have. So as you enter from Maharashtra, you have a substation. Now that entire load comes at that substation, and then it is driven down up to the extreme end of south, to the whatever GED has an infrastructure. That definitely takes a toll. Okay, and so you have quality issues and all those things, and then Ponda substation getting overloaded, it feeds Verna, it feeds Kundam, it feeds even Shelde, which is at heart of south, which is actually a substation 220 kV, good enough to cater this. But Shelde also depends on Ponda. If Ponda fails, even, I leave that blackout scenario of that, even if Ponda fails someday because of all this overload, still there is a problem. Because Ponda almost caters to half of Goa. The Shelde substation, even though it caters to south, the feed comes from Ponda, because this feed, Ambewadi, is not reliable. It goes on tripping 100 MW peak. So it is having a dependency on this. This gets power from this. So whole power comes from Kolwale, this Tilari 220 kV and 400 kV to Ponda. So the reason, the decision taken was that as you have a substation here, you need a substation in south. Once this substation comes, one is this substation gets connected to this western grid also by extending one line from here to here and getting a direct line from south and connecting to this station. So that way, this whole thing in picture, Goa gets connectivity from both regions. So a scenario, if Western Grid something happens, no problem. Equal capacity is there from Southern Grid. Southern Grid something happens, equal capacity is there from Western Grid. And all good, you can even actually have double the capacity to bring in power if at all it time requires. So that is the whole concept. Every state, most of the state, or every network has to achieve that N minus 1 reliability. N is the number, minus 1. Whatever the answer you get is reliability. So if N is 1, in your case, N is 1, Maharashtra, only West Bengal. If one n is one, n minus one becomes zero, means no reliability at all. So if n is two, this and this, and minus one, one goes off, you still have power. That's the whole crux of this project. So getting a substation here, once the substation comes up, then a 220 kV line is constructed to connect this with the Shelday substation. Once you connect it to the Shelday substation, what happens? Shelday substation gets a high quality power because directly 400 kV comes from both sides, and it 220 kV 20 km line, just 20 km like in electrical terms, it's a very short line. So almost it's like adjacent. You get a quality power at Shelday directly, and Shelday caters to entire South Goa. As well as GED has a plans immediately because the line passes from nearby Ponda, so they also take Ponda into circuit from this station. So this Ponda and Shelday start getting additional feed from southern region as well as western region. Ponda releases Shelday load, Ponda gets overload, comes down. It can cater better to the other parts. Shelday directly gets power, it can cater better to southern Goa. And there are two more bays. I'm not sure about the plan, but definitely there is a possibility that there can be one line directly taken to Varna also, because Varna they are putting up a new 220 kV substation for the industrial purpose. So that also get a better feed. These are the advantages. So this once happens, solves the issue for next 20 years at least, because with whatever pace you can go, even now you are at 650 megawatt, another 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, even if you reach 1200 megawatt, the infrastructure caters. That's the biggest part of it. So this is how, I mean, these are all scientific figures. The particular planning commission keeps on working dedicated people across the country on this, like what is the requirement, how it is going up, what will be the need, how it will be catering for next 10, 15 years. It's not only about today, but whereas right now the sad part is even today we are in trouble. What you are seeing right now is 650 megawatt. Even today, I talked about a very, very crucial and very, very drastic scenario. But now also this line trips, or this line is taken into maintenance. Whenever this line is taken into maintenance or tripping happens of 400 kV, there is a shortage of 300 megawatt, 200 megawatt, depending on one circuit goes 200 megawatt. How GED caters that? It's simple. They cut off the load to the industry. Because the mandate of the government is not to cut domestic loads, which is not in case of other states. Other states always, you know, as a debatable subject, but always a priority is given to industrial load because that's a high revenue source. Because industries are charged at 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, that can subsidy can be passed. So that's a logic. That is why you must have heard, even in Maharashtra today also, and past few years back, there were places where it used to be 8 hours shut down. Power cut, 4 hours power cut. Even cities like Thane and Pune has seen 6 hours power cut for domestic. But at that time industries were running, up and running. But here industries load are cut. So what industry has to go through? They have to rely on DGSET. DGSET power is not just unaffordable, it is getting further and further unaffordable with rising prices. Plus the biggest part is it's directly polluting the environment. You're burning diesel. Goa has almost like 2.3 times to 3 times the diesel consumption than the national average, which is, yeah, almost 3 times. Now it doesn't take much guessing where the diesel goes. Goa definitely doesn't have 3 times of vehicles than any other state. Definitely not. So it is, the diesel is going in DGSETs, and that's why you are consuming so much of diesel. Even today if you go in the evening at any particular tourism spot, rampantly the diesel jets are burning. Why they are? Because power is not continuous. And for so many industries, continuity of power itself is so important that you cannot even afford to have a cut of half an hour. So they prefer to have something with some very crucial operation going on. They prefer to be on DGSET to have continuity. So those are the effects. So this is how the project is being designed. And that is the requirement of the project. Now coming to the main part. So when we design this project, when we make the routes surveys, what are the guiding factors for making this survey? First and foremost guiding factor. A survey is never done or never considered for a patch where there is a habitation or where line has to go above any built structure. Now that can be any structure. We don't know. In fact, when we take a forest permission also, we have to convince forest on paper in the visits also, that this is unavoidable. If I go out, I'm going into habitation area or something like that, where I cannot take, that is why I have to come inside. Only for that area, when it has been asked, when it has been, you know, convinced by all the forest visit due diligence, only then forest will approve the proposal. So whatever the forest we are covering, it is because wherever we would have come out of forest in that places, we would have gone over the habitation. So habitation, so definitely no. So there is no houses coming below line, no temples, no churches, nothing. Absolutely nothing. And then it goes to forest. Now even in forest, so we were aware here, first of all, there is a lot of talk about environment study, whether it is done or not. It's a very interesting fact that environment study is what? The study on environment, right? How it will affect the environment. But something which is not having any emissions, any hazardous flow or anything, how it will affect the environment. And on this very reason, the EIA itself has kept transmission line away of the Pardu, that they said is not, no environment studies, prior studies are required. Prior or ever are required for transmission lines, because there are no emissions. There is nothing which is, if I was putting a power plant here, it's altogether a different ballgame. There is something to be produced, there is something to be burned, something to be, the waste or something, waste management or. There is no emission, there is no waste created, nothing. A tower goes, a line conductor goes, which tells it is not creating any waste in future which needs to be managed or nothing. On that pretext only, EIA notification has clearly stated that it is not required for transmission line. So to see it with the same lens of any other infrastructure project would be a mistake. So because the other projects are totally different. If I'm constructing a road, I'm going to definitely, there will be emissions on the road. Because there will be moving vehicles on the road. So this is the thing. Then comes, so definitely environment thing is not required. But when we are in Goa, we know that Goa is full of biodiversity. And specifically one of our areas we were coming, because the whole line was decided, it was discussed even in the 39th SCM, that there is no other route done avoiding Western Ghats. All 8-9 proposals they discussed, Western Ghats were imperative. In fact, there is a discussion in the 39th SCM saying that they specifically discuss about that Kaiga route. They said that Kaiga was stuck up for so many years because Tiger Reserve and all. And then this agreement came up that let this line allow, this time further we will not take line from Tiger Reserve. So there was one option to bring the power from Kaiga. So that was discarded because of the same reason. So then there were other alternative options which were mainly hovering around Narendra. So Narendra, either we go inside the substation or we go near the substation. The substation had a limitation on number of receiving bays. So we decided to go outside. So the proposal remains same. But in terms of options, it looks like two. But there one, anyway going up to Narendra comes. So now, when we go to Narendra, to enter Karnataka, we know that anywhere you go, you will enter forest, wildlife and such things. So where we decided, there was one route which your existing line passes to Ambevadi, which passes mainly through Molem National Park and Bhagwan Mahavir Sanctuary. That was one of the options with us. So we studied that. Not that we did not study the existing one. We studied that. Even in 39th SCM, it was discussed that if at all required, GED will be allowing to work on that route. They can discard if required. Okay, it was not a mandate that it has to be done. So we studied the both ones. After studying both the routes, we submitted that to the forest department. Because when we applied forest department for the survey, forest themselves asked that you give us the details of both and then we will allow you to further require permission. So we studied both the routes. The existing one, 110 kV to 20 kV route and whatever route we could find. So this is the data. This is the sheer comparison. If I went to the existing route, my line length would be 11.71 kilometers. And total number of towers inside Goa will be 32. In my route, which we now proceeded further, the line length comes to 16.331, which is almost 4.5 kilometers longer than that line. And number of towers have also increased. Second thing is, in this, 1.3 kilometer passes through Molem National Park. which is full of biodiversity, which is like major. In this, it is zero. So whatever we boost or we take a pride of scouting this group is actually, it was worth investment of time and everything, because we could achieve a bypass of Molem National Park. And then wildlife in this case itself, also wildlife also comes around 4.84. In this it is only sheer 2.51, and in that 2.51 also interesting part is 0.51 is here and 2 km is here. Now this 0.51, even if I take you guys today at the location, you will see there is not a single tree where a tower is getting down. But only because I cannot come out because there is a habitation here. I have to avoid the habitation, so I have to skirt with the boundary. And because technically it is coming inside Barwara market, technically, under the markings, so it has to be considered as a part of proposal. That this kilometer also gets proposed. So only this 2 km actually we are going through Bhagwan Mahavir Sanctuary. And there also, here the 2 towers are coming and here 4 numbers of towers are coming only. So total 6 towers in Bhagwan Mahavir Sanctuary. Instead, in the existing route, if you would have gone, 13 number of towers will come in Mahavir Sanctuary and 4 towers in Molem National Park. So 17 towers will come in protected area in place of 6. In terms of hectare also, here it will be 28 hectare, it will be it is only 11.54 hectare. Now this important figure. You see this, and even this figure. Both the figures are less than 50 acres. If you go to a Parivesh website where the forest approvals are to be uploaded, you get an option of uploading a biodiversity assessment and biodiversity management plan only if you put this figure as 51 or 50. If it is less than 50, the option doesn't pop up. You cannot upload. It's an online system, right? So definitely it is not a mandated one, it is not a compulsion on us. However, without anybody asking or without, while before you are submitting, in 2018-18 itself we initiated a biodiversity assessment for the region. We got the report. In 19 we got the report. We could not upload, but we submitted the hard copy to Forest Department with the hard copy what we submit. The report is available here also. As well as the report is very well published by us on the website. And the copy what you are seeing here in the desk is the biodiversity report. So this was done willfully, just knowing that it will help us to further find out how we can further mitigate. Although it will so that particular report, the experts have a very high quote. Is the experts quote is the line does not divide forest into two parts. Because the towers are at a distance of almost average 400 to 500 meters from each other, and the conductor passes up and above, so it has no kind of fragmentation or division of forest. Light goes as normal. The impact of this particular construction activity is localized on the tower footing, definitely, because there might be cutting requirement and all. The other impact, they said, can come through approaching that location. While approaching that location, you can damage the things. And while pulling the wire, that's called a stringing process. So there we got our technology in. We said we will not access the location by vehicles up to the tower location. Wherever the motorable road is available, we'll go there, stop there. From there, we will head load the material. This is not something which we are just planning to do here. This is what an adopted practice, which we already adopt in other states. We concluded just now 62 towers in Arunachal forest. Erected 62 towers and even the stringing is completed. All the towers are in the completely in forest, and not just forest but under cliff of the mountains. So this is all a mountainous area. So initially for almost 15-20 locations, we took the material and loaded. We got special vans to carry 25 kg, 30 kg each, and they used to carry the load and take it. Cement, steel, water, metal, everything. And even tower parts, anyway, tower parts come in disassembled parts. They are like angles and structures. So they are also carried and then assembly is done. And further, we went there to expedite it further because of COVID and all those things also came. We didn't want too much manpower. We deployed a helicopter and then the whole material was dumped at locations by use of helicopter. This is just recently done. The helicopter operations went on from October 1st to December 15th. We did almost 3,500 tonnage of material. We shifted to all the place, towers, conductor, everything. Moral of the thing, why I'm saying is, to reach those 62 locations, I have not created a road. We have not taken any vehicles. We have not cut any trees to get access to the location. Whatever we have done is only at localized location, only at tower for the area. That exactly is already done practices by us. Then comes stringing, where is a possible of getting damage. So we are using drones. Again, this is also a proven technology which we already adopted in India. We are doing it for so many years. So with this, we avoid laying of those conductors down and damaging the things. That's one part. And another part, while designing itself, what we have taken care, designing the towers or placement of towers. Even if in Bhagwan Mahavir Sanctuary, if you see the placement of towers, they keep on increasing the elevation. So they start from low and they are like going in a straight line, higher and higher and higher. At one space, to reduce the number of tree, tower footings in the area, so to have a lesser impact, we have taken wherever possible a span of 630 meters, a long span. The only requirement for to do that was so that we can not have. So otherwise there were 7 towers. But taking that longer span, we could manage it only. So that also is possibly done. And then we are getting a huge clearance there. We are getting a clearance more than 20, some places 25 meters from the ground. Now what that converts to me? What that converts is, when I talk about a corridor, a conductor goes, the distance between the tree canopy, top of the tree, and my conductor, if it is more than 5.5, I have nothing to do with that. The tree is only a threat to a line for tripping or anything, if it is in that range of 5.5 meters. So if I am getting a clearance of 25 or 20 meters, say, I won't say 20 meters, 20 meters, 20 minus 5.5 is 14.5. So any trees that are below 14.5 meters, I have not my concern. So I don't have to, although I have enumerated it, I don't need to cut it. Although I think it. So again, this all these figures rolling out are the figures of enumerations. Now let's understand why it is enumeration. When we do a forest proposal, we have to enumerate the entire corridor what is prescribed by a CEA. So for 420 is 46 meter. So when 46 meter is this big corridor, complete corridor. We have to entirely enumerate all the width of 46 meter along the length of the line. So now that, why it is done? Because as per those enumeration, whatever the number comes, forest calculates the NPV, net present value, and the, whatever the hectare comes, they calculate the compensatory afforestation, CA what they call it, CA net, compensatory afforestation. So that is calculated based on that. So for that purpose, that enumeration is done and that money has to be paid. Now that doesn't mean that whatever has been enumerated has to be just gone and cut there. So cutting requirement comes to very minimum, because wherever the tower footing will come, like I said, in Bhagwan Mahavir itself, this two tower doesn't have any tree, so there is no tree to be cut. Balance is 4 towers. Even if I say I have to cut 70 trees or 60 trees at one tower location, 60 into 4, it would be like 240, 250 trees will be actually required to be cut, and then balance tree are coming under corridor. So corridor also only trees which will be really very high might be need to cut or trim. So that is what we are trying to say. So wherever these numbers are there, these are enumeration numbers. Enumeration doesn't mean, and that is why we have given in writing in SBWL, when we enumerated total 4,300 odd trees in Bhagwan Mahavir, and they said, can you keep it below 1,000? We said yes, and it is recorded in the minutes of meeting that our tree cutting in Bhagwan Mahavir Sanctuary will be less than 1,000. It will be restricted to 1,000. Now if we were not confident, we wouldn't have given it in writing. We would have just made a verbal commitment or something like that. But that's in record in a State Board of Wildlife meeting. So that is how it goes. And so these are the, basically, as I already explained. And then further, some of the mitigation measures what biodiversity helped us report. Now they suggested us to go with biodiverters. As such, the birds are flying, migrating birds, something like that. So we are installing diverters on the conductor at the exhibition spacing.
which emits some sort of light. So if at all the body is exactly on the flight path, they can divert the flight or something like that. Then restriction guards so that no other crawling animals, you know, climb up. This is, and near the substation also, you know, wherever we need to have some sort of access road, we are also making sure that the road is constructed along with this kind of culverts, huge culverts, so that even like, you know, the animals, like usually in that area there's a village area also, so you call it cows or anything, they can easily pass through without any disturbance or not to come on the road. So these are these kind of mitigation measures have helped us from the Bangladesh airport. If you just look at those pictures, then go back on the picture. So this is the actual picture. So you see the forest below. And this is not just one picture. This is across the world. If you scan the pictures, like be it a highly developed country or whatever it is, the lions are passing through forest. So the whole logic is because this particular area, as you see, the tree height is less. It doesn't affect the conductor. Doesn't harm. Only tree cutting. And in future, even below the tower also something comes up. Because in agricultural land, people do agriculture even in the tower base. When we put a tower, and that is why in past, when they used to construct the transmission line, the only compensation was provided was on loss of crop. Only on loss of crop. Being in agriculture, because that time it was understood whatever loss you make is only to the crop, because next year you can very well farm there. But now the things have changed. Now there is an importance given to the land also, so that is a different factor. But then this is the thing. So logic behind it is even below the tower you can do agriculture, or you can have come up in the other parts. If this area, even if it is not having any trees below the corridor, you can very well plant medicinal herbs trees, which are going to be dwarf trees. All those things can be done. So those are the things which are coming from our biodiversity reports. So I guess that's it.
I'll just make a suggestion for questions, you know, because some of the electronic media requested that they have to rush somewhere. If print will give me 5 minutes. And also, it is a small place and actually wanted to keep it less, but quite a few people are there, only keeping COVID in mind. If you'll give me 5 minutes, I'll finish with the electronic media bites outside and then come back so that those who want to leave at least can
leave.
It's okay. Your presentation is enough.
Yeah.
Okay. If there is separate bite or separate
question. So there is something separate. Now there is a question, but someone wanted bites and wanted to leave, that's all.
For this entire project, as I said, the number of tree cutting comes to in this line only Bhagwan Maru, only 1,000, less than 1,000 trees are required. Only in Bhagwan Maru, like actually, they are less than 1,000. For the other, also the figure is something around the actual counting is 11,000, but the actual cutting will be required maybe around 4,000 or something. So, in total for this line in Goa, it will be only 5,000 trees. Less than 5,000, again I am saying 5,000 is higher
percentage. 5,000 or less than 5,000?
Less than
5,000. If it is 5,000, so let me bring to your notice is that at least your presentation was good. I think so. Even the government has not been able to give us anybody a presentation like this. Now, who is telling lies from your side or the government side? I don't know. Because there have been statements from government, even the power minister, like 16,000, 81,000, where this figure and how your figure came, it's really surprising now.
No, so that is what I'm trying to convey to you. See, if you calculate my enumeration numbers, if you calculate my enumeration numbers, okay, there are two lines, two 400 kV lines, one from Mapusa to Sangod and one going from Sangod to Narendra. So in that Sangod to Narendra, there's a Goa portion. And Mapusa line completely is in Goa. And there's a small 220 kV line going to Kepe. If you see the actual numbers, which has come as an enumeration, as I just explained to you how the process of enumeration happens, even that is 43,000. So I don't know where the lakh is coming, okay? Actual enumeration count is 43,000. In that, as I said, 4,139 is Bhagwan Maru Sanctuary, where we are already committed that it will be 1,000. And in general also, we said that we will be restricting ourselves to whatever we are counted, we will be restricting ourselves to less than 35%.
No, I am saying that there have been n number of press conferences called up by the power minister explaining about this because there have been opposition in. But they have not come to a certain conclusion like how many trees or something, like the number which you have given now and the number which they have been differentiating. So when government gives a permission, the government is government pulling with trying to tell people the wrong.
So government is I would say government might have given the figure from the forest department, which I am saying it is 43,000 enumeration. Okay, 43,000 enumeration, whereas we are saying by this method what I explained to you, that the actual for entire Goa, for all the lines, will not be more than 14,000. That's how it is. And that too, it's a speculation. Because we are trying our best. See, I will tell you one interesting fact. Now, there is also a figure going on. There are a lot of social media happening that in Mapusa line, which is coming, in non-forest area, there will be 22,000 trees cut. You must have heard that figure, right? Why that came? See, it has come back to us, a goodwill has come back to us. We tried to expedite this project. In Goa, for non-forest trees, what is the rule? If it's your land, you have to apply for a cutting of a tree. Okay? For even to apply for cutting of tree, your papers should be very clear. The land papers and all those. This hampers the process. So, in the interest of the project, what we did is, we said we will apply for an entire line for a PPA on behalf of, you know, as a project basis. So that it will be brought under the proper purview. And so there also what happened, forest asked us if you are doing that, you enumerate entire corridor. So again entire corridor was enumerated. So total figure came up of 22,000. Whereas now for actual cutting, what I would be requesting, we have done the whole study, again that joint assessment is going on, final check. For actual tower footing, for entire line in non-forest, against 22,000, the number what has come to actual requirement of cutting is 1,013,000 trees. 1,000 trees for almost 76 to 18 tower locations. So where is 22,000? Where is 1,000? See, but for if you might want to make a story, 22,000 is an appealing figure.
It's not a make a story.
No, I'm not talking about, I'm talking in generally who are putting it on social media. 22,000 is an appealing figure. Has anybody approached and checked what is the fact in this? So that is only for PTA purpose, for taking a PTA approval, because you cannot show lower figure, you have to show a larger impact. So the entire corridor was missing, but actual cutting requirement is coming only to 1,000 numbers. Balance some trees will be loping, trimming will be required under the corridor. There also, as I said, in many places we have taken towers on such a cliff location that below corridor nothing hampers. There are cases also, there were some of the people requesting us, our trees are coming, we studied that case, we gave them a proper reply. See the location, you are almost going at 20 meter height in your area, you have a plantation below that is not even getting affected at all. So we are not going to come and cut it, there is no requirement. That we are confirming to people also. We are going to each and every location and we are showing the people where the tower location, the tower land is coming. Even now, we are trying our best. Because it is in our interest, we are trying our best, okay, wherever the tower can be plotted in non-tree area, we tried that. Unavoidable, we could not do. So that is how it is. So 22,000 to 1,000. Now, if you catch up these figures, now everything, I told you my figure very honestly, 43,000, you can check with the forest records. The total enumeration figure for all the lines comes to 43,000, which I am saying, I will keep it below 14,000 for forest. So this is how the breakup is.
43,000 is total.
Total calculated figure.
Including the branches of trees.
Everything. 40,000 is for the entire corridor. But that is for the purpose of payment of money. That is for the purpose of payment of money. I have already paid for the two approvals what we have received from Ministry of Environment. Stage 2 approval. We have already paid 30 CR. That is on what? For NPV and for CA. Compensatory afforestation, that goes to government compa account. So that we already paid. So in spite of that, it is not that because I have paid I am going to cut the trees. I will cut only what is required.
No, what I am saying is...
If there are any other questions, if it's one-on-one, we end the session and take it.
No, why?
It is
important. I will ask
you.
It's important.
I'm just checking if anyone else has a question.
If they want to ask, let them ask. I don't have a problem. I'll keep my mouth shut.
Yeah, so I'll just moderate them. If there is anyone else, so that they can ask.
Yeah. I think to make presentations, I will ask you. पण सोशल मीडियावर असे काही फोटोज व्हायरल झाले जिथे खूप झाडं
ऑलरेडी
आहे, त्याबद्दल आपण इथे प्रेझेंटेशन मध्ये काहीच आम्हाला दाखवलं नाही, पिक्चर दाखवलं नाही किंवा त्याबद्दल काही माहिती दिली
नाही. आय विल कम टू दॅट. आय थिंक इंग्लिश इज ओके ऑर मराठी?
इंग्लिश.
सो in that context, see, okay, again that is misinterpreted. See, what this is the whole line what we show you, okay? And for this line, as I mentioned, the most heart of this project is the substation requirement. So we purchased the land in Sangod, okay? In 2018 we actually procured a land in Sangod. Now I will just touch up that part also, because that is also element coming lot of in social media. This project simply talks about a substation in South Goa, and the purpose is to connect it with Shelde. That is very clear. It has to connect it to Shelde. So there was some kind of understanding at that level, just speculations, that if at all GD has a land, it is good to have that station in Shelde somewhere, on the presumption that GD holds a land. Okay? When we came here, there was no land. We approached government, we got a letter from Darbandara deputy collector, we got a letter from Kepe deputy collector. There is no government land of this scale available in South Goa or in this area. So you please look for private lands. Second important fact is, in the TSA, that agreement what we hold with Government of India, Central Government CEA, it clearly says that the substation location has to be decided in consultation with Goa Electricity Department, because they are the ultimately the end beneficiaries of that. So it has to be their opinion and their requirements taken into consideration. So we started looking for private land. GD was also with us. So one of the GD officials also helped us to find one land. But that land was in the reserved forest area. So converting reserved forest and all those things, that is what. Then we found out the land which is private. It was claimed to be private. We checked, it is private. It was not part of any forest. Then it was not declared in any of the two committees formed for private forest declaration. That was not part of that. All these checks and balances done, then we followed the family tree, did the due diligence for almost 100 years. And we found 120 owners for that property. The sale deed was done with each and every landowner of that property. And that property was acquired. So that is a private land in a Sangod village. But it is pitched in as if it is part of Molev National Park. It is not. It is only in Molev Panchayat area. It is not a Molev National Park, or it is not a forest land. There is a forest nearby, normal forest, not a protected forest. But this particular patch of land is a private land which was acquired by the company. Now we acquired that land. Now as we acquired that land, it is a private land. It is not a private forest, because when we have done this particular FDP proposal, what I am saying, and this enumeration we have done of trees, it is not just for reserve forest, it is includes private forest also. So we have paid the money for private forest as well to the government. Okay. So it is not that only reserved forest, whatever in the line, private forests are also coming, are also seen with the same lens as the forest. But in this substation case, it was not a private forest, neither a part of forest, it was a private land. So we definitely needed to develop that substation. So we said we need to cut those trees. So it was asked, as any private owner, you and we are all here, the owners will do, we'll have to apply for a private and a private tree act for a cutting permission. We applied for that. We applied for a cutting permission. We received the permission after 7-8 months that you can cut these trees, after the file moved all levels and everything. And then this is a very important point I will note here, that we got that permission somewhere in April 2019, and we started the work somewhere, we intimated as per the requirement, we intimated that we are proceeding with the cutting by 25th or 24th of June, and then we started slowly, and then actual cutting started in July, August, and it finished in December. There was no COVID in December, right? There was no lockdown in December. So the cutting was over. None of the people, none of the voices even approached that the trees cutting is happening. The whole cutting was done, and then the logs were stacked, and then the COVID struck. COVID delayed our process of stacking the logs and taking it out, because for taking the logs out also, we need a formal permission for transportation. We cannot, even if it is our land, our trees, we cannot. It has to be recorded, foresters to see, come and see the logs, segregate firewood, what is firewood, what is all those things, all those
procedures need to be followed, they give a permission, then the truck can go out. That got delayed because COVID came and the logs got stacked and that become a perfect picture to shoot. That is what exactly happened.
So even the national news channels carried a wrong story, you mean to say?
Definitely.
How much?
Because $2,600.
How much
you are
paid for government?
We are not paid for government. Under PT Act, you are supposed to plant the trees. So we have planted 9,300 trees.
Somewhere else.
We need that plot for development. So that plot, so in Sangor, Kodar and Pusgar, we have planted around 8,867 trees, and in GIM we planted around 500. So that is how we have almost planted 9,300 trees. So sir, your question is, if somebody has taken a wrong story, I can only tell you that no level channel approached us to really verify the facts. If somebody would have approached, I would be more than happy to give the right picture. So even nobody checked whether it was really, because there are so many stories going that, and it's very emotional cut, that where people were sleeping under lockdown and locked in their houses and trees were cut. False statement. Trees were cut before December. There was no COVID. Free movement was available to people. Mm. So this is the fact. This is what I just want to, and that is why I'm thankful that I have an opportunity. People are here and asking questions.
Sir, what's the risk assessment that they have done regarding this construction?
What kind of risk assessment, sir?
For the birds.
So as I said, we have done the biodiversity assessment. That report is published on the website. The biodiversity assessment covers the biodiversity, the flora fauna in that area, the animals in that area, the birds in that area, all the things it covers. That is why it is a big report, which first covers all those things and then it provides a biodiversity management plan. There are two segments to it. One is assessment and another is management plan.
What is the impact on the output ability here?
Pardon?
Any impact?
So as I mentioned, the biodiversity study says that the impact will be localized on cutting of the trees, localized for the tower footing, and there can be impact for accessing that location. So in transmission line, the impacts are localized and moderate, because once the tower comes up and once the stringing happens, there is no disturbance on a regular basis or anything. So even the regeneration happens. So it is localized and temporary. It is not a permanent damage. If I construct a road, then I am making a permanent damage, because then nobody will be allowed to grow any trees or anything on that portion. It will divide into two parts. But for a line, the biodiversity assessment also clarifies, because the line, the conductor passes at a height of about 15 meters, 20 meters. There is no impact on a wildlife or any normal life going below that. That is the assessment being done.
Mr. Peter Beck, I hope I have pronounced your name right. I have three questions. One is the parallel route that you spoke about. If you could put back that slide, please. The comparisons you had with the one that is existing to Ambedkar.
Correct.
And then the projections show that the route that is chosen now causes less damage in terms of trees to be cut, as well as number of towers. But the fact is, you already have a line here. So now what you are doing is, you are taking a totally separate area and causing a double damage. You got the point. This is the point that is being made by most of these wildlife biologists and most of these wildlife.
Agree. Okay. You face the question of answer.
So your projection that you have chosen a better line in terms of impact on environment is false flat on that part. So this whole balance or the comparison of the two lines, at what level was that done before choosing this line? Was it done at the MOEF level? Was it done at the CDC level? Was it done at what level? Before this present route was chosen? That is one question.
You want to take one by one, actually?
Fine.
I will answer this question. It's a very interesting question, yours, and I'm glad you asked this question. Because I am very happy to say that how it is not false. Okay? The line which is passing through that, you are aware what voltage level it is? You are aware?
Yeah, it's 220.
220 kV is operational, sir.
Yes.
110 kV we are talking about. The root to be used is of 110 kV because 110 kV is VPA. Please understand, 220 kV is operational. It means cutting it off now means you are completely striking off 100 megawatt for 2 years or 1.5 years till this project comes. That's a big decision. Okay? Because you have to first remove that line, then construct it there. Understand one thing, as I just told about regeneration. The 110 kV line was constructed in 1970.
Yes.
Okay? If you visit that line, even the tower has trees on it. Completely. I have the pictures. I will show you. I can send the pictures to you. The towers itself has trees on it. The regeneration is at such a level that, and when I say the technicalities are not like that, that there is a tower and I go and put this 400 kV conductor on it. It doesn't happen that way. 110 kV is a voltage level, it has certain clearances, it has certain conductor capacity, it has certain conductor weight. It cannot hold a weight of a capacity of 400 kV level tower. Neither 220 kV tower can hold it. You need to construct us different towers for that. Okay? Now those towers cannot be just extended on a 220 kV tower. It is really good as a common man, as a student, even I was also thinking how it can be just like, you know. But a tower is designed on a weight thing. So a 220 kV tower, anything if tower needs to be strengthened, it cannot be strengthened on the top. It has to be strengthened from the bottom, right from the foundation. It has to stay there. So you have to actually remove that tower, remove that foundation, if you want to use the same location. Or otherwise you will use an alternate location nearby. So when you go for alternate location, those patches are not clear patches for me. That there will be no trees. There are actual trees. And this particular assessment is done walkover, actually. Okay. 110 kV route has completely this many trees are coming. So again I am saying, my figures are coming when I calculate the corridor. 110 kV corridor is just 21 meters. So even if I use that corridor, I am using partly that corridor. I still need another 26 meter corridor. So my counting will go in 46 meter and these figures will come. So we never said, see this is, we just kept a picture to forest department of these two things. There is a letter from Deputy Deputy Conservator of Wildlife to Deputy Forest Officer for the proposal on both the routes. He categorically explains his logic and his rationale why he is asking his suggestion to Forest PCC of Hanoi, the letter which came to us, why to follow this route. He says this particular route, first of all, it is zigzag because it almost travels near the road and all those things. Then this particular area, the spotting to the sensors, what they have, the spotting in the wildlife has been much more in this area. The reason he gives it has rocky escarpments, which is a very, very, what you call this, high grazing area for gorse and those kind of animals. So the sighting of wildlife animals is much more in this area. That is one point besides. It is zigzag, that is another point besides. Number of towers, footings, as I said, the impact happens on more on locations. So I go much more locations, I definitely have to, the impact will be much more. Whereas this route, as that report says, it doesn't have much of a rocky escarpment. It is a mountainous terrain. So there is not so much of wildlife, you know, sighting there. It goes straight. It is not zigzag. So it occupies only 6 numbers and it goes on a cliffs. Those were the merits he posed. And that is how Forest, after submitting both the report to Forest, Forest asked us, go ahead that you start making enumeration on this route. And this is exactly we shown to CEC as well. So I will go on records, I think Empower Minister has gone on records. We have nothing against that this route or something. Our intention was very clear, minimum damage. So we went with this route which clearly cited minimum damage. If today, because we might lack in some kind of vision when it comes to diversity experts and all, so if they feel the damage here, though in numbers, is nothing compared to this and have to be go by this route, we absolutely have no problem. It is just the two alternatives are mentioned. Because for your information, even in the...
Even at this stage,
the only thing is the impact will be on the delay of the project because the whole process has to be started once again. That's the only thing.
Second question is, you very categorically said that EIA is not required. because it is not a no emissions and that. But I think this issue is subjudice, isn't it?
It is not subjudice. EIA issue is not subjudice.
Goa Foundation.
No, there is nothing. There is no challenge on EIA. There is no challenge on any court on EIA requirement, because I understand whoever are challenging, they definitely are that red. And the EIA notification is very clear about this. There are letters from EIA also to various companies and various governments on the same subject, that there is no EIA required for transmission lines. Letters from
even when it goes through wildlife
sanctuary. You are mixing two things. EIA is environmental assessment and BIA is biodiversity assessment. So I think I clarified the other point also. Biodiversity assessment also is required if your area of damage or area of diversion is more than 50 hectares. It is mandatory. So we are not mandated at all, yet we have done it. So the question was, because they went ahead and they saw it is not available on the website. So I gave the reason why it is not available, because we could not upload it. However, it is very well submitted to forest and very well made available to any common man on our website.
And last question is this whole, you know, justification for this project in Goa. Of projections of power requirements, you know, like the white paper that the power minister came up with has been demolished by most experts. And once commissioned, what would be the demand from Goa on this project?
Demand from Goa means?
Means how much of power would Goa accept from the Kalmar project?
As much,
in terms of capacity.
As much. It is 1200 megawatt capacity.
No, I agree. But in terms of demand and supply shortfall or excess from the existing sources for Goa government, how much would be the report?
You are getting confused here. Kamnar project is nothing but infrastructure creating for government itself. What infrastructure you have from power grid already line up to that particular line. Similarly, another infrastructure, it's a government national grid infrastructure getting created. So it is not about how much power you draw from Tamna. Okay? This particular line, once it gets drawn, you get connected to both the grids. Now it's up to the government from which exact power plant they want to procure the power. Because what you require is just a highway. You have the system in place, you have a import capacity, you can go anywhere and buy your power across India. So right now you are only buying, Goa government is buying 100 megawatt from Vamamunda. After this, they will start buying much more power from Karnataka, where there is a solar power plant coming, or any other solar power plants or wind power plants in Karnataka. Government can very well do. Right now they don't want to do that because you don't have import capacity itself from south region. So this is just, this Kamnar is not producing power, Kamnar is not responsible.
Wheeling, it's basically wheeling.
It is only wheeling, it is only creating an infrastructure for you so that the power can be bought. Now it's totally government decision from where how much power to be exchanged. That is completely GEV's call. And I'm not sure, I mean, what creates a doubt in people about the requirement of power, because definitely we know that we are growing.
I'll tell you what creates the doubt.
Yeah.
30 years ago, IPP was proposed in Goa. An artificial shortage was shown. 6 years back, the project shut short. Goa didn't face any problems. So this whole, you know, projections and the way demands and supplies are projected are always, you know, in favor of a private project that is coming. So that is the doubt.
So one thing, a more important point is, this is not a private project, first of all. Although it is a public-private partnership, these projects are all of Central Electricity Authority. They are based on, so it goes on public-private partnership or it goes on. Now the similar kind of projects in Rajasthan, now Power Grid backed the projects. They back to the same mode, not directly given to Power Grid. They bid it, they quoted, even being a government company, and they got the projects. So across India, we ourselves are doing project in Gujarat and we are evacuating 3,500 megawatt from renewable energies, because that is up and available for grab and there is not enough transmission structure. So that is bringing it into the main grid. So that is a requirement of the project. Here, Goa needed an infrastructure to get connectivity. It is one is somewhere it is required evacuation, somewhere it requires connectivity. So it's only the infrastructure which was designed
for 2015 when it went on TBCB mode, it was not known who will be doing this. Very well, Power Grid could have done this project. It is all about tariff-based competitive bidding, who has done it. So whenever who has designed this project, they have not kept in mind that which company is going to do this project. It is just a requirement. The first decision was either they could have just given some project directly to government on a cost-plus basis, but slowly, slowly, government is more and more moving on TBCB for two simple reasons. One is to bring accountability and completion period for projects being shortened, because there is a conditions, timeline, everything. When it's government to government, it's only cost-plus. It goes on for 10 years, okay, after 10 years, whatever cost. Second, all that money is directly going to the government's pocket, directly. When it's a public-private thing, there's an investment on it. That's the only simple reason. So the logic you are applying for IPP, again, is different because IPP was generating.
I'm just giving you an explanation why doubts come up.
I agree. So IPP, I know you're talking about Reliance IPP.
Yes.
So first and reason for its failure was that was a gas-based power plant. Okay? And gas is a fluctuating power. There was a recent, just yesterday I read an article on Japan, how Japan is dealing with the power bills, because they are also highly dependent on the gas-based system. And natural gas shot up in this COVID situation. It like went 1,000 times. So similar
thing.
So what is what happened with Enron? Same thing. Huge, beautiful project was coming up and there was so much of fight and the power purchase agreement and all those things. It went, because NAFTA is not sustainable. Power producing by gas, it is subject to market prices. It's like diesel only. Diesel way increasing, so slowly, slowly. So that, but as long as I know, that power plant when it was there, even it was producing expensive power, it was definitely not affordable for government to buy it and subsidize to give.
That came in afterwards.
Exactly. So that is the reason. So now the lesson learned is there is no need when you have so much of power in India as a country, and only thing we need the connectivity. If you have a better connectivity, you can be always, why you need to again build something. I think we did not cover one of the part, even the solar when the people talk. Solar has a big footprint. Solar has a, what you call as efficiency rate of not more than 20-22%. It simply means if you have to produce 300 megawatt, you have to construct 1500 megawatt. If you construct 1500 megawatt plant, your size would be, you have that? Your size of land required would be 7,500 acres. Now tell me 7,500 acres of land, a plant to be developed. Will it not involve destruction? Where you will get that kind of land in Goa?
So solar is not viable.
It's not a viable, I'm not questioning viability. I'm saying on a mass production level. What government is doing is fantastic. If people start putting it on rooftops, it's okay. When you're talking about the main source of energy, if you have 600 megawatt and you want 300 megawatt coming from solar your own, let's say Goa produces it. What kind of land? Now Karnataka is doing it. Karnataka is putting 2,500 megawatt solar power plant. In Bhuj and all what I'm talking, They are in gigawatts. Why? The Ran of Kutch is there. Ran of Kutch, open land, high efficiency, 20, what do you call it? All 12 months, availability of sun, no problem. So that is where Rajasthan is big solar centers. Karnataka is big solar center, where there is all these areas. Their wind is also, they are going to combination of wind and solar. So at night wind produces, in the daytime solar produces. In that combination, the power is being produced in India. India is very aggressive on renewable. So the what is need of the hour is connectivity with India. So no matter, because if Rajasthan produces a gigawatts of power, does Rajasthan state need that much of power? Definitely not. They want to somebody to buy it. For somebody to buy it, it needs to be transported, right? That's how the logic works. So Goa is only getting its infrastructure created so that then it has a freedom to buy it from Western Grid, Southern Grid, both sides, wherever they want to. That is what the logic goes behind it.
You spoke about some substations, 220 kV. Like how many substations are there in Goa?
This is the existing substation in Goa. Ponda is there, Shelde is there. And I got mentioned some, there are in Ambona and all those things.
Because there were six substations which the power minister announced. And that we, I think so, six substations which were supposed to come, new substation. Whether those are the same ones,
no.
Because he has announced way much better.
See, there are two things. This is a national level infrastructure project, okay? This project is completely national project, and even the funding or whatever this investment in this project is entirely from center. Not a single pipe from government of Goa. So this is actually an infrastructure boost to Goa through center. You're getting an infrastructure. Whatever power minister must have mentioned is the plans of Goa Electricity Department. to strengthen internally.
Connecting this, same, getting the power from the same line.
Not. It will ultimately, see, you, that is internal. It's like you are doing, you are making a supply line for your house. Now, if your house is much bigger, you can have your distribution plan as you want internally. You are, first of all, getting secured that you are going to get supply. You are getting a gas pipeline, then in building, you want to, how you want to distribute, it's up to you. If you want to create more centers and something like that, it's up to you. Substation will definitely need to have this thing. So those are the internal plan.
Correct.
As I said, Verna substation is coming up.
Correct.
So now if Verna substation directly gets fitted through this, it's the added advantage.
Prime Minister was well aware of getting all these things before it could be made brought before the public. This issue I'm talking about.
No, not necessarily. See, this thing was anyway required. Now also, whatever the substations what our Power Minister might have quoted, they are anyway required. Okay, as for a distribution purpose, internal distribution purpose. But even though you improve that, if your main import itself is not good, how it will help?
I got your point. But what
I just wanted to ask you one. See, you said about 6:40 is our requirement, except peak hours. That is, say, between 6 p.m. to 11 p.m., we have surplus power involved.
Surplus?
Mostly peak hour is our load.
Peak hour is your load, but even other times you are more than 550 megawatts.
But sometimes I don't know,
they say
we have surplus.
No, so that is what I am saying. See, surplus, who calls it surplus? You are actually buying power from open exchanges.
Now trading region.
You are buying power from, so if trading. if you are surplus, sir, why you are going to open exchanges?
Now it is trading.
And if you are surplus, tell me, sir, why you are running DG sets in Goa? Why you are running DG sets? Goa should be a model example. Why you are running DG sets in Goa? Surplus power. You are buying, contradictory to all the statement. Exchanges, when you go, when you are finished with your quota, then you go to open exchange and buy the power. So I really, see, that's what, and I clearly shown you the figure.
No, earlier there were instances when Goa is to sell power. Now I think the trading is happening.
They still sell.
No, it is trading, I think.
They still sell.
Trading happens. So Goa now produces only 3%. Maybe when Reliance was operating, it was having some more power.
No, that was 38.
The point here is, see, there is no fun in having power plants in Goa. Power plant is again environmentally concerned, whatever it is. Be it coal you don't want, even gas also it will emit. Gas also will have emissions. So rather than producing power in Goa, it is always better to have a highway infrastructure created so that you can buy as much as power you want from the neighboring states or from the grid. Not just neighboring states, when you're getting connected to grid, it's nothing to do with neighboring states.
So you're only adding infrastructure.
It's only and only and purely infrastructure what center is proposing for Goa, so that Goa is ready for future as well. Now also the problem gets solved and ready for future.
That work on the towers have already started?
Yeah.
Or it is already completed?
Not completed. In this line, we have completed 14 number of foundations.
Foundations?
Foundations.
So where exactly? Where in which area side?
In Kolwale side and this thing. From this Mapusa substation we have started.
But as per my knowledge, recently the cabinet has approved that permission for those towers or something.
That is only for evacuee portion.
Four towers something. Right?
Evacuee portion. Cabinet has approved for the in this line in Goa there are many parts, right? So some of the towers are coming on evacuee land.
Yeah,
evacuee land, we whom to go? We have to go to government to give the permission. So the fight was put up to government that evacuee land and let us know there should be official permission. Private owner, you are the owner, I can go to you. This is the land, this is the whatever compensation.
Correct.
Evacuee whom to? So that permission was given just now.
So it is only for that floor is in the evacuee property?
Only evacuee property. Whatever you are working right now is not evacuee property, it's a private land.
So total how many have almost like completed?
14 numbers.
14 numbers.
14 foundations we have completed.
How
many
foundations?
We are directed towards now.
So one of the
criticisms
is mix up people.
Evacuee property is charged.
Evacuee charges. What is your private property? Nani ke katle?
Usha manaya nahi. Yena tar kabila usane charge pe tha. Ham karne charge toh yeh rupee kahi dauna hai wala. Santar ka sahi. So 10
10
is koi na. Actually
necessary. Whether the land use for the building. Exactly.
So it is already done that way now. So we have 3 survey numbers there. And in the 2 survey numbers only we have cut the trees for developing the substation. There is one more survey number 24/1. which there is no trees or anything is cut there as it is. Okay. That is the area where we have just proposed in future, when this substation is operational, it is always advisable to have a staff staying nearby. Okay. So for them, a staff residence was planned there. And as a part of residence, a small badminton court or something is set. But that is not a very mandatory thing that we can always take a decision on. So it is kept parked now. We are not going ahead anything with that. The main requirement is substation, that is the heart of it. When the substation comes, so that is what only is being utilized right now. That whole entire survey number is left as it is. It is, there is no, not even, we didn't even apply for tree cutting there. We didn't even apply.
And these locals, you know what, like you said, there was no objection until December 2019. So what do you think, you know, could have been the trigger suddenly in 2020?
So ma'am, trigger, I would say, is exactly the NBWL approval. What I saw the things popping up, because then we started getting clubbed with railway and road. And we started being seen through their lens. Railway and road are the big mega infrastructure projects, which definitely create a huge footprint. And so, because this was also one of that project, we started getting, so that is where the EIA came, DIA came, so all those things. Because we started clear comparison. Now if you compare transmission line, there is no comparison with any infrastructure projects. They are leaving a footprint, whereas we are not. So that is where the whole thing started. That is what I am saying. So if there was really a concern, it could have come in 2019.
This was April 2020.
Because NBWL approval, because what happens, forest was keeping, railway project is 2011 project. Mamata Banerjee approved that project. And she was railway minister. Kept on going, there are various phases, it was stuck for so long and all those things. So that also approval was stuck with forest department for long, road was also maybe patches. And then we joined in. Our process also took almost 2 years. So ultimately when forest got sorted, all those things, they got the decision. Because see, the biggest concern what the department was having here is for any kind of this project, there is a requirement of CA land, compensatory afforestation land. So that is a big question mark in Goa. It's a welcome or it's like, you know, what you call a good pain. Because you have so much of density and trees, and you don't have that much of barren land available. But that has become a problem. Where to give that land? Because railway was asking, road is asking, we are asking. So due to all those things, it was stuck. And only because of that, then they approached, because that is the procedure laid by the Ministry of Environment. If you don't have a land in your division, you ask for other division. If other division also doesn't have, you ask for the neighboring state. If neighboring state also doesn't have, you go for further other states. Those are the things. So they went to neighboring state. Maharashtra did not support much. Karnataka said, yes, we can provide. And that is how this thing about, you know, people saying that the trees are cut here and the forestation will be done in Karnataka. But it's all about the procedure thing. If you had that land, that could have been given in Goa. They were not having. Only when they got that much of land commitment from Karnataka, then the all the project proposals were moved. Then it was put up to, so wildlife area was involved for all three projects, so it was put up to State Board of Wildlife. After State Board of Wildlife concluded in December, again that happened normally, not in the COVID time. 2nd December 2019, State Board of Wildlife concluded. Now usually State Board of Wildlife meeting is what you call an elaborate one. There are environmentalists, there are all those people. So there we committed that 1,000 for us. Mitigation measures, they said, okay, you have to reach 2,000. We said, okay. Then it went to NBWL. And the NBWL meeting happened in April, and from there it started.
So this, there were some questions, you know, like about, there were some questions by locals, like one of the things was some procedures were not followed. I mean, from the state government side, not from your side, like Gram Sabha was not held. So do you think that created like state government not following some basic procedures, it kind of hindered the process for you?
So I don't feel so. In fact, these are all the assumptions and requirements, and all every person has their own opinion, and they are being very strong. For this kind of thing, the whole process is about, we need to apply to panchayat. Okay, panchayat itself is a government body. They can take a resolution and give a resolution. That is okay. So whether Gram Sabha is required for that or not required for that, it's completely subjective decision of those panchayats. It can be their own practices, how they are conducting all the decision making. If they are all decision making, they are conducting really through Gram Sabha,
different matter. If they are not, just because this is there. So it was, see, for panchayat also, this was first time of this scale of project. I don't think those kind of panchayats have dealt any proposals of this scale. They might have odd proposals of small building or something like that. This is something coming up with a, such a large thing. So what we actually found when we interacted with panchayats also that time is, their simple, a very, very genuine and simple concern was, we are okay and happy that this will help Goa, but what will be benefit for us? Those kind of things were their understanding. So first of all, they thought it is a power plant. So we clarified that no power plant. So it can't be, you know, so many people working there or something like that. Yet then there were some, they asked for a basic support. Okay, you know, something should be there. Some people should work here. So we don't have too much of openings here, but then we still committed some like, okay, whatever the, oh yeah, whatever the jobs which you don't require much of an interviewing or skill set. Unskilled job around, we scouted at what we can, we came up with a figure of almost 12-13. And we said, okay, this, as soon as the substation comes up, the permanent positions of whatever unskilled will be coming, we will give a big preference or like keep it, reserved for the panchayat area. So that's how we could do our bit. That's the only thing. Otherwise, we could not support much.
Okay, I know we've gone for over an hour, and there are some who had 1-1 questions as well. So if we can, I think, close the round.